finance. I'll shmup. What is the inverse relationship between interest rates and bond values? Okay, people, think of Batman hanging upside down. Not with a date on a Saturday night, but, you know, just as his normal course of business. So yeah, bonds have this same strange inverted relationship with financial gravity. When prevailing interest rates go up, like when the Fed makes the cost of renting money more expensive so it can fight inflation and other bad guys, then the principal values of bonds goes down. Think about it this way. Imagine you just paid $1,000 for a piece of paper from the reputable corporation Whoop-Dee-Doo, the world's leading manufacturer of whoopee cushions. Anyway, Whoop-Dee-Doo promises to pay you $60 a year for 10 years and then pay you back $1,000. Alright, a year later, however, the world's economies take off and a new president commands that we fight inflation hard so that old people living on fixed incomes don't get evicted from their homes and have to live in SUVs parked by the side of the road. Yeah, we don't like that, and yeah, that happens to old people. They can't afford to take the risk of owning stocks in the stock market, so they generally just own safe bonds and end up being subjected to inflation risk. That is, when the government paper that they own is safe and pays bond interest of 3% pre-tax and 2% after-tax, with the world inflating at 3% a year, meaning old people then gradually see the buying power of their savings wither away to nothing, and, well, that's why we fight inflation. So the Fed, the thing that controls the price of renting money to banks who then rent the money to borrowers, the Fed then raises the price of renting that money hoping to bring down inflation. Well, that price hike then makes the cost of renting money for a corporation way higher. That higher price of renting money is collateral damage from the bombs the government is setting off to fight the war on inflation. All right, so back to Whoop-Dee-Doo paper. Now, with the federal fund rate hikes, the cost of renting money is more expensive. The company thought they could get away with paying 6% rent on the money they wanted to spend on their whoopee stamping factory, but now the cost of renting that money is 8%, and those 2% difference points are a big deal on $100 million. $2 million a year is meaningful to a company with a, volatile product. So now think about it from the perspective of all the people who bought 6% corporate bonds of similar risk and duration as the ones Whoop-Dee-Doo was going to sell, i.e. apples to apples in all respects except the interest rate. Well, almost overnight, the rate of return on those bonds looks anemic at best. Those old, crappy 6% bonds now need to yield a sexy 8% to be competitive with the new or current market environment. Well, who would want to own those old 6% low-yielding bonds, which should now yield 8%? Answer, nobody. The 6% paper sells off, or sells down as people sell their bonds, until that 6% a yield equals 8% a year yield. More specifically, previous investors had paid $1,000 for $60 a year in yield. Well, now that yield has to be $80 to match the new environment as set by the Fed and the marketplace. So the mathy question here is, what price must the bond be selling at, the one which originally sold for $1,000 par that gave 6% yield, so that that bond now gives 8% yield? Well, the price has to go down so that the $60 of yield, or something, let's call it X, equals $80 over 1,000 or 8%. So that's 60 over X equals 0.08, or 60 equals 0.08X, or by dividing both sides by 0.08, you get $750, yeah, which is the new price of the bond after the Fed's rate hike caused corporate bond rates to go from 6% to 8%. Got it? Are we following here, people? The yield on that old $1,000 par bond, which was 6% when it was issued, is now 8% because the market price of $1,000 a unit that investors were paying for that bond has fallen such that the bond at $750 a unit, paying $60 a year, now yields 8%. So it should make sense that bond values would fall something equivalent to that number. It's like a teeter-totter, so that when rates are high, par value of old bonds are low, and vice versa. Yeah, that teeter-totter thing, everyone uses that as an example. We waited until this far into the video to regale you with it. And key self-awareness issue for you nervous Nelly investors, you don't have to sell the bond at this price, by the way. You could just hold that 6% formerly yielding bond for the remaining 9 years, get your grand, and move on. You still will have made 6% a year year on your $1,000 investment, which is good, just not as good as that juicy 8% you could have gotten. Okay, if all that hasn't confused you enough, let's add one more degree of difficulty here just to keep the Bulgarian judge evaluating us happy, because, you know, he lives in Bulgaria, so, yeah. Well, hidden in those numbers is the fact that a buyer who would pay $750 for your bond would also get the $250 of appreciation on the bond over 9 years to then get paid back their principal. So in real life, the bond wouldn't fall fully to $750. There would be some recognition of the roughly $250 divided by 9, which equals $28-ish a year in extra financial return on top of the interest. And oh, by the way, that appreciation would be taxed each year as it appreciated in value. So what happens if things go the other way? Well, yeah, the bond yields continue to fall, and that $60 a year you paid a grand for has prevailing similar risk bonds selling at 4%. Like, what happens if inflation goes the other way? Well, the value of your fat yielding bond would go up, right? The market's only paying $40 a year to rent that grand, and you have this awesome piece of paper that pays $60 a year. So the value of your paper would be bid up in that setting, right? All right, the math. 60 over 1,000 gave you 6% a year return when you bought the bond, but now the prevailing rates are 4%, not 6, so the value of your $1,000 value bond must change. It becomes X. Unknown, mysterious, yes, like Batman. So 60 over X must now equal 4%. We multiply both sides by X to get it out of the denominator, and you have 60 equals 0.04x. Then you divide both sides by 0.04, and 60 over 0.04 is 1,500. So yes, in that short window of 1 year when interest rates fell from 6% to 4%, your bond's value skyrocketed like a Manhattan Batman, building from a grand to being up 50% to $1,500, sorta. Remember that now this big premium slowly fades away over time. You're only gonna get back that original par value $1,000 when the bond matures. So over the next 9 years, that $500 in premium will slowly decline at about $55 a year, thereabouts. So in real life, the bond's value wouldn't actually hit $1,500. It would do well, just not that well. And yes, what a roller coaster it's been riding that bond investment, brought to the highest of heights when interest rates go down, only for the bond value to plummet back down once interest rates jump again. So the lesson, I'm not sure. That's your job. All we know is in this poor schmuck's case, it'll be best to pick a ride with a "you must be too tall to enter" sign. Aww.